Hello viewers, welcome to this week's Raxio Hour, the third in the month of September 2021. This week, we feature highlights from the panel discussion at the recently concluded FITSPA Conference under the theme Building a Safe and Regulated Fintech Ecosystem, where Raxio Data Center was a proud sponsor. The FITSPA Conference is an annual event that converged all leading players in business, government, technology and world-class financial service solution providers in order to better navigate shifting landscapes, helping businesses embrace and drive the transition to a digital future, as well as unmask the power of technology. James Byaruhanga, our general manager, was also a panelist at the conference under the sub-theme National IP Policy, Data Privacy and Data Storage, alongside fellow panelists such as Stella Alibateese, the National Data Protection Director at NITA-U, Maxime Dieudonné, co-founder Safe Boda, and Kainobwisho, the Registrar General at the Uganda Registration Services Bureau, URSB. Let us listen to what they had to say.
Fintechs and enterprises and financial services companies like banks, insurance companies, name it, anyone, any player, to be able to actually comply with the changing times in regulation, data sovereignty is critical. You need to be able to keep data in country, and the data and the data you keep in country should be able to comply with the regulations in the same geographical jurisdiction.
Government in February 2021 released the Data Protection and Privacy Regulations. These regulations were necessary for the implementation of the Data Protection and Privacy Act. And basically, the Data Protection and Privacy Act is a law that regulates the collection, processing, and any other activity relating to personal data. And as fintechs, this is a very key topic because fintechs in many cases rely on analyzing and utilizing a lot of information. And in many cases, most of this information includes personal data.
There's competition in the marketplace. It is a business strategy for you to protect your intellectual property. It is a competitive tool that you are in this market with many other players. We have so many players in the communication sector. We have so many players in the finance sector. We have so many players in the health sector. How do you distinguish your product from that of your competitor? It can only be achieved through protection within the various intellectual property systems that we have in place.
Don't go just yet. Stick around for a more laid-back conversation between James Byaruhanga, Gerald Begumisa, Managing Director at Yo Uganda, and Doreen Lukandwa, Vice President, Global Enterprise at MFS Africa.
Do you think the proposed act, the National Payment Systems Act, does it have any say or play around, for example, withdrawal fees? Because I think that's the biggest challenge there is around e-currency right now. It's like people starting to, the thing people say, like, send me money but put on withdrawal fees. What's your take on that? I personally find it so irritating. I'm like, if I tell you to come and physically pick the money, you're going to spend more than the withdrawal fees. But why is there a mentality issue, like a culture issue around that?
Well, the thing with withdrawal fees is you have to take into consideration the person who is performing the transaction. So you kind of have a merchant to think about, and if they are not happy, then you don't have a business case. Without the merchant, it won't work. And I think one of the things that the MNOs have done is try to use the fees as either incentives or deterrents to uptake of their services. And like I said before, it's one thing to be a subscriber or to have subscribers. It's another to have lifetime users or active users every 30 days. And so they've kind of used that as a carrot and stick type of approach. So the best way, I think, to eliminate that would be to either subsidize on some of the costs associated with performing those transactions. And that is ultimately going to maybe happen with more collaborations, I think, reducing the cost of operations, and kind of turning these agents into more than just a mobile money agent, but complementing them with additional services.
You see, like, now I see the telcos are building their own parallel companies for fintech, right? Same as the banks. With more focus now on say fintech from the banks and from the telcos. How do you think that's going to be? Do you think it will just widen the market and make it way bigger and like more pie for everyone, or will you start seeing some cannibalization of some market segment?
I think it will widen the market because when we look at how the fintech space actually evolved, it was through investment by the telecoms into the agent networks and basically educating the general public, because that is actually a hurdle which a number of people overlook, and that is what is at the top of the mind of the average person on the street. Do they actually understand what a digital payment is or why actually it is useful for them? And so there's quite a lot of benefit that came from these investments in education, in infrastructure from these large players, and which created also secondary markets for the likes of us, for example, as aggregators, integrators, and solution providers to businesses.
Yeah.
So I see it as something that would widen the market as well. They have huge budgets for marketing, and so that education aspect is very well done by them, which we then, of course, benefit from.
Yeah, can leverage.
We support a customer.
You know, when you're talking, I'm thinking about cryptocurrency because it's been on my mind for a while now. So what do you think? How do you think it's going to fit in?
Again, I think that crypto will mostly speak to those who've already experienced digital currencies, who know what it means, who know the benefits. Again, for me, it boils down to value proposition. If it doesn't make sense, you won't have a high uptake. I think a good example is retail payments. Think about how long it took for MTN Momo to take off. And ultimately, it was because you had two players. You had a customer who has mobile money, and you have an agent who needs to receive that money. The problem for the agent is, how do I get my cash now?
Yeah.
So yes, you may have the demand on this side, but how do you settle the end of this equation? So making sure that that's sort of like the ecosystem is complete end to end from a digital perspective.
What do you think is going to be the biggest attraction from fintech, or the biggest play from fintech to be able to get into a serious space and be treated the same way these traditional huge industries are treated?
I think it's already starting, and the most obvious thing is that the law and the regulation, and that is a very big recognition from the level of the regulator to actually start licensing fintechs. So now in the eyes of the users, the general public, or even the businesses who are customers of fintechs, or even the government itself, fintech is already mainstream. Fintechs are becoming regulated institutions, and I think that was one missing part that actually was prejudicing a number of fintechs in the eyes of customers or even other partners in the space. There being the regulated institution and then this grey area of fintech, which no one could say whether it's really regulated or whether there are, or whether it's not, or whether it's legal or illegal. But now the regulation, I think, provides that missing link.
This has been quite interesting and informative. We hope you enjoyed yourselves. We're just getting started, as we are already gearing up for the Uganda Network Operators Group UGNOC Conference on 29th September 2021. Until next time, have a lovely weekend.